Hello, my dear children. I am Nisha S, here to teach you chemistry. Did you do the problems based on Raoul's law? I am sure my children will definitely obey me. Did you have any problem? You might have solved the problem because I have trained you how to solve the problems in chemistry as well as in life. And we stopped with something related to non-volatile solute, and I asked you to remember two main points based on it. What was those points? Those where the lowering of vapor pressure takes place when you add a non-volatile solute in a solvent. And second, the lowering of vapor pressure depends only on the amount of solute. It does not depend on the nature of the solute. Am I right? These were the two points which I asked you to study, recollect, and then come in the next class. So I am going to start from where I stopped. Okay. My aim, or our aim, I don't have a separate aim here now. Our aim is to prove that the lowering of vapor pressure is dependent only on the amount and not on the nature of the solute. So we have a small derivation for that. So we will study it. This derivation is required in our next topic also. So that time we will only have the final equation discussing, but not the derivation. Okay, so now listen how what we are going to do. How do you calculate, I have a doubt, how do you calculate lowering of vapor pressure? Leave vapor pressure. How do you calculate lowering of your marks? Suppose first term you had 50 marks. Second term, by some reason, I don't know whatever happened, your marks have reduced to 30. So what is the lowering of marks that has taken place? How will you calculate it? 50 minus 30. Am I right? You agree with me, no? Similarly, when water was the only solvent present, then the vapor pressure is called as what? Vapor pressure of pure water, which I am noting it as P0A. When I added the solute to it and mixed it, I am getting a solution. And at that time, what happened? Vapor pressure lowered, just like from 50 to 30, the vapor pressure lowered. And that lowered vapor pressure is PS. Then how will I calculate the lowering of vapor pressure? How much amount it lowered? How did we calculate the marks? 50 minus 30. In the same way, P0A minus PS. So P0A minus PS is called as lowering of vapor pressure. It is called as lowering of vapor pressure. So, we are going to prove lowering of vapor pressure is directly related to the amount of solute, which is the symbol for solute we use, B. But you can see, my heading is not lowering. What did I write? Relative lowering of vapor pressure. What is relative lowering of vapor pressure? Nothing very big thing. Just a small thing. The same thing itself with respect to a constant value. Just like relative density, this is also the same thing. Lowering of vapor pressure with respect to a constant value, which is a constant value, P0A, vapor pressure of the pure form. That means P0A minus PS by P0A, that is called as relative lowering of vapor pressure. Okay, relative lowering of vapor pressure. So this is what we are going to show. It is dependent on mole fraction. So both are concept-wise the same. This we are just making it in a standard way with respect to a pure form. That is all. Okay. So how are we going to derive it? So our assumption, what is our assumption? A is a solvent which is volatile, and B is a solute which is what in nature? Non-volatile in nature. B is a solute which is non-volatile in nature. So when I mixed B with A, I got a solution. It has a vapor pressure. What is that? PS. And actually, based on Raoul's law, what is PS? PS is PA plus PB. But now what is the problem? B is what in nature? Non-volatile. So B cannot evaporate, it will not contribute anything. So can just neglect the term PB. You get me? Why did I neglect PB? Because B cannot contribute anything, no vapors. So PB is not there, that term is equal to zero. So since PB is equal to zero, why did I take it is equal to zero? Because it is non-volatile in nature. I can say PS is equal to PA. Again, Rawlsow will help you to derive the further things. What is PA? PA is equal to P0A chi A. So I'm just going to substitute it. We know that PA is equal to P0A chi A. That I am going to substitute here. With your permission, I am going to do it. PA is equal to P0A chi A. In between, we have to think what our aim is. In your life also, it is like that. When you run a long distance, you have to recollect, what was my aim? Why am I running? So in the same way, in between now you think, what is our aim? Our aim is P0A minus PS by P0A is dependent on the amount of solute that to express in mole fraction, that is chi B. That means I have to keep chi A one side. Am I right? So for that, I'm going to bring P0A this side. Very simple. So what happens? PS by P0A is equal to chi A. But a small problem. What is my small problem? Chi A. It is with respect to the solvent. I want to show the relationship with respect to what? Solute. No, I know. Ideas are coming to your mind. Yes, exactly that. I just have to subtract both the terms from one. Okay, whatever I do in LHS, if I do it in RHS, then that addition or subtraction, whatever it is, that it gets cancelled. That effect gets cancelled. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to subtract both the terms from 1. From 1, I will get 1 minus P0, sorry, 1 minus PS by P0A is equal to 1 minus chi A. You know what is 1 minus chi A? What is 1 minus chi A? 1 minus chi A is chi B. So we reached our aim. So I can say, when you subtract it, what will you get? P0A minus PS by P0A is equal to 1 minus chi A is what? Chi B. And we succeeded in achieving our aim. Successfully we derived it. P0A minus PS is what? Lowering of air pressure. P0A minus PS by P0A is what? Relative lowering of air pressure. That is equal to what? Chi B. What is chi B? Mole fraction. Mole fraction means what? Amount. Amount of non-volatile solute. So we achieved our aim. We proved that the relative lowering of air pressure is related to the mole fraction of the solute and it doesn't depend on the nature of the solute. Whatever be the solute, it is related to the mole fraction of the solute. So is it clear how did we derive it? We derived it with the assumption that B is non-volatile. Remember in your exam also, whatever, whether it is A or B, you have to mention that B is non-volatile, or if you are taking A as non-volatile, you have to write A is non-volatile. If you don't write that, then the answer doesn't make any sense. Okay, so we successfully derived the expression that P0A minus PS by P0A is equal to chi B. Okay, now with this, we are coming to a very, very another interesting topic. Ideal and non-ideal solutions. So what is your concept of ideal solution? Last year in 11th you have studied ideal gas. Am I right? Leave it. Let me ask you a question. What do you mean by an ideal student? What are the qualities you expect from an ideal student? An ideal student is a person, a child, who obeys all the rules of the school, all the rules of the teacher, all the subject teachers, homeworks, assignments he completes, he is not absent on any day. He strictly follows the rules and regulations of each and every member of the school. Am I right? This is what we have the concept of an ideal child. So let me ask you one thing. Do you think that such a child existing is possible? No. Each human being is unique and characteristic in nature. So it is not practically possible. In the same way, let me just first start ideal solution by telling you that ideal solution is something, a theoretical concept. Practically, no solutions are ideal. Okay, so what is ideal solution? As a child who obeys all the rules and regulations of the school is called as an ideal child. In the same way, ideal solutions are solutions which obey all the rules which govern the solution. Which is the rule that governs the solution? Raoult's law. Am I right? So ideal solutions are solutions which obeys Raoult's law. So I have a doubt. Suppose in this much concentration, it is obeying Raoult's law. But as I change the concentration to this much, it is not obeying Raoult's law. So will it be called as an ideal solution? No. If that is the case, you all children can be called as an ideal children. But for me, all children are ideal. Okay. So you have to specify the condition. What is the condition? Which obeys Raoult's law at all the range of concentration and temperature. Okay, so ideal solution, when you define it, if you don't include this term, then your ideal solution's definition is not correct. So once again, how do you define ideal solution? This is very important question. How will you define ideal solution? Ideal solutions are solutions which obey Raoult's law at the entire range of concentration and temperature. Clear? So I told you, it is not practically possible. Almost near ideal behavior are shown by some solutions which is formed by mixing components have almost similar characteristics. When I say the example, you will understand what is it. N-hexane, have you heard about N-hexane in organic chemistry? N-hexane, N-heptane. Benzene, toluene. Methyl alcohol, ethyl alcohol. These are few examples of those solutions which are not ideal but almost similar or nearing to ideal behavior they will show. When you look into this example, something strikes you. What strikes you? If you look, these are molecules or compounds which are having almost similar structure. Am I right? Hexane and heptane differs only in one carbon, right? So benzene and toluene both are having a ring structure. Only one additional substituent is present in toluene compared to benzene. Methyl alcohol and ethyl alcohol, again, they are having almost a similar structure, only the difference of carbon atom. So what is the conclusion that you can come across? A solution can behave ideally. What is the first condition you come across it can behave ideally? If both the components that you mix, that is the solute or solvent or A and B that you take, are having similar structure or they are having similar polarity. They are having similar structure or similar polarity. Such components, if you take them and mix them, then they may have a tendency to behave ideally. Or second choice is that if I decrease the amount of one component to very, very, very small extent and the other component I am taking to a very large extent, then in Henry's law I said, you can neglect this term. Do you remember? In the same way, when I dilute it to the maximum, then the solution behaves as if it has only one component. Which is that component? This I am showing it in this hand. The other component is neglected because this amount is very, very, very less. In that case, again, it behaves ideally. So the two options where a solution behaves ideally is when you form a solution with components having similar structure and similar polarity, or amount of one component is very, very less. One component is very less. In that case, the solution tends to behave almost ideally. So what are the characteristics of ideal solution? Ideal solution shows some typical characteristics. See, I am an ideal child. I am an ideal child means I don't look left, I don't look right, I sit straight. Am I right? I don't interact with the other person in the left. I don't interact with the other person in the right. If I interact, I will have to talk. Then I cannot listen to the class. So exactly same way, two components I'm mixing, this component and myself. Both are ideal means, what is it? I am not looking at him, he is not looking at me. In the same way, both the components are not interacting each other, so that I can say there is no change in enthalpy. When they mix each other, some bond is formed, some bond is broken, then only there will be enthalpy change. Here we both are not interacting at all. So what happened? There is no bond formation, no bond breaking, so that there is no change in enthalpy. So the first point of an ideal solution is that delta H mix is equal to zero. Another thing, you remember in the class, when you're with your friend, what will happen? You will sit along with him like this, so that some space changes there. Or else he'll come and sit near to you, so again some space changes there. But here, I am not mixing with him, he is not mixing with me, so there is no change in volume. Am I right? So I can say delta V mix is equal to zero. And the third, my interaction should be exactly equal to his interaction. That is why we formed ideal. That means I can say that AA interaction, BB interaction and AB interactions are all equal, are all equal or same. So three main characteristics of ideal solution: delta H mix is equal to zero, delta V mix is equal to zero, and AA interaction, that means interaction between my molecules and interaction between his molecule is called as BB, and AB interaction is the interaction between our molecules. Since we are of same structure and same polarity, our molecular interaction, remember interaction earlier case, what did I say? We are not mixing each other. Now what I am saying, molecular interaction, that is different, which is an internal change. Molecular interaction is the same and they are equal. So these are the characteristics of ideal solution. And of course, you know that they obey Raoult's law, means it follows all the equation. What is it? PA is equal to P0A chi A, PB is equal to P0B chi B, and P solution is equal to PA plus PB. So with this, we come to an end for today's topic. Before we wind up, once again, the main point we discussed relative lowering of air pressure. What is relative lowering of air pressure? P0A minus PS by P0A, and proved that it is equal to chi B. Then we discussed ideal solution, and I have written in the heading non-ideal solution. Purposefully I wrote it. I will not discuss it. You will find out, and next class you will tell me what are the characteristics of non-ideal solution. Okay, once you know ideal, it is very easy for you to predict non-ideal solution. I will help you, but you will share the points with me. Okay, so what is ideal solution? These are solutions which obey Raoult's law in the entire range of concentration and temperature. Remember, that term is very, very important. Then no solutions are practically ideal. Some examples I gave, that is N-hexane and N-heptane, benzene, toluene, methyl alcohol, ethyl alcohol. And I told you, what is practically the possibility to make an ideal solution? The possibility is that select the components which have similar structure and polarity, that means similar molecular interactions. Then other possibility is that you decrease the amount of one component very, very less, so that the solution practically behaves like a single liquid. That means it behaves like ideally. Then what are the characteristics of ideal solution? Since they are not mixing each other, delta H mix is zero, that means no bond formation, no bond breakage. Delta V mix, since they are not coming closer or moving away, there is no change in volume, so delta V mix is equal to zero. And since they are formed by the components with similar molecular interaction, I can say that AA interaction, BB interaction and AB interaction, that means after mixing, AB interaction, all are equal or same. I hope everything is clear to you. So I am placing a challenge before you. Next class when you come, you should be ready to explain what is non-ideal solution and its characteristic. So till then we meet. Bye. Thank you.